Moving back, okay, this is our grade. Remember, this is where we made our cut for our grading. So I'm left with the loin section. That back muscle runs down the back. I'm going to further break down this loin into a short loin, as you can see why it's called a short loin, and a sirloin. Short loin is more tender than a sirloin, because the sirloin gets closer to the leg. However, both are fairly tender, remarkable. This is probably the most popular steak right now in a lot of places because of its value, its price. Okay, we're seeing less of these on menus because of their price. Okay. This section here, as you can imagine, the loin muscle continues, that graded surface continues, only now it would be called a strip, okay, if it were boneless. If it were boneless, it would be called a New York strip or a Kansas City strip. What's the difference? The accent is pretty much what I said. No difference, it's a top loin steak. I've seen it marketed as a Orlando strip, San Antonio strip. It's a top loin steak, boneless. Okay, some people will talk about there being a bone on there, but it's not really the difference, okay? But as we move back in the animal, another muscle starts to get bigger, okay? And it's a muscle that sits in this big bed of fat. The kidney there, and then there's this big bed of fat around the kidney, we call the kidney knob. That muscle is sitting on the back side of the backbone, okay? So it's sitting in a channel of bone, and it's covered in fat. So my joke is that it's basically sitting in a lazy boy eating Cheetos all day and doing nothing. Really doesn't do anything, so it's very, very tender. That's why it's the tender loin. Okay, and it gets bigger as it goes back in the carcass. So if I were to leave this bone in and start cutting this on the bandsaw, that would get bigger and bigger and bigger. So this bone here, which makes a T, would be called a T-bone steak, as this muscle is here. As we move further and further back, essentially here we're going to get two or three steaks that we call porterhouse steaks. Okay, essentially the tenderloin has gotten to a large enough size. We can call it a porterhouse. Now, the way that we can guarantee, and by specification, we guarantee that it is a certain size, is that we pick up the presence of this third muscle here. This is the jump muscle, what we call the rump muscle. It's the gluteus medius. Okay, it's like our gluteus maximus, but it's the gluteus medius. When you get far enough back this exists, you're guaranteeing the size of the tenderloin. And that's actually the specification for a porterhouse. Okay, so T-bone, 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 porterhouse. Again, a very large cut because it's composed of many muscles and bone. I can pull this out boneless, like I said, and make your strips. Problem is, when you get strip steaks on the back here, in this back end, you start to pick up that third muscle, that jump muscle. Okay, a lot of wholesale guys call those vein steaks because you're going to have to remove or scoop out that bone, that muscle. Okay, it's got a slightly lower value on a plate. You can take this other muscle out whole, this tenderloin, cooked whole, it would be a Chateaubriand roast, or cut in steaks, it's a filet mignon. Okay? Moving back, as you can imagine, that rump muscle just gets bigger, the gluteus medius just gets bigger. Okay, and that's the primary muscle of this sirloin section, or the sirloin steak. It's a nice valued steak because it is a middle meat, but it's further closer to the leg. Okay? We don't really have a market for bone and sirloins anymore. We used to have the paddle bone sirloins, we don't anymore, they're boneless sirloins now. And typically they're top sirloins, okay, so just the top section, and not getting into a lot of the geography here, but we have bottom sirloin as well, which we're marketing as flap, okay, as well as tri-tip, okay, in the interest of time, I'll